So, Paper Mario discourse has become increasingly unpleasant over the past few years. There's a lot of shouting and sectarianism between fans of the original games and that of the newer ones. This has become even more complicated after Paper Mario the Origami King managed to be surprisingly good, despite only taking baby steps towards the image of the series that fans want. There's been quite a bit of discussion about all the restrictions that have been placed on the team at Intelligent Systems by Nintendo, and that begs the question of why. What exactly has caused Nintendo to want to do this to their second-party developers? When they let the series be creative, it gave us Paper Mario the Thousand-Year Door, one of the best games ever made, which is clearly indicated by how many times Nintendo has re-released it. One of the biggest disappointments surrounding Paper Mario Sticker Star was the removal of any type of story elements in favor of the basic plumber goes and saves the princess from the evil turtle man that we've played through a million times already. All of the unique world building and cool side characters were gone and replaced with this super generic Mario world filled with nothing but toads. According to an interview between the dev team for Sticker Star and the late Satoru Iwata, this was a request placed on the team by the man, Shigeru Miyamoto, himself, who saw an early build of the game and apparently remarked how it was too similar to the Thousand Year Door. The game's director, Kensuke Tanabe, told Iwata in this interview something that many gamers point to when discussing the changes to the series. Aside from wanting us to change the atmosphere a lot, there were two main things that Miyamoto-san said from the start of the project. It's fine without a story, do we really need one? And as much as possible, complete it with only characters from the Super Mario world. So apparently, Miyamoto told the development team at point blank that he doesn't want them to have the game feature a story or any original characters at all, which seems a bit odd. The whole point of Paper Mario was that it had a story and made the Mushroom Kingdom feel like a real country instead of just a series of obstacle courses. There are a few aspects to this that we need to look into before we can really dig down deep into analyzing some of the potential reasons as to why the series has changed so radically, which is what I intend to do here today. The first idea that we need to tackle with Nintendo is to understand what their stated design philosophy was at the time of Sticker Star's release, and what the trajectory of the series was up until that point. Supposedly, it's the idea of innovation that drove the decision for the Sticker Star team to completely upend the series status quo and turn it into the final product that we got. Apparently, Miyamoto is a huge proponent of innovation for Nintendo franchises. In an interview from 2014, he lamented what he saw at E3 that year as a sign of stagnation within the industry. This year, the majority of what the other developers exhibited was bloody shooter software that was mainly set in violent surroundings, or, in a different sense, realistic and cool worlds. Because so many software developers are competing in that category, it seemed like most of the titles at the show were of that kind. Now granted, Nintendo has its fair share of formulaic franchises. Pokemon and Zelda are probably the first ones that come to mind. And that Miyamoto actually addressed the somewhat more cookie-cutter approach to some games in 2013. We obviously are interested in bringing out new ideas, but at the same time, we also have our hands full trying to bring many of our popular franchises to new systems. So the struggle for us then becomes, how do we find the balance in there and try to deliver the content that people want while also surprising them with something new? He then specified that this was about finding new ways to iterate on existing games in order to keep them fresh, using the example of 2012's Animal Crossing New Leaf. Animal Crossing is a game we've been making for essentially 10 years now in different iterations. With the latest version, we finally feel like we fleshed out the Animal Crossing idea into sort of the definitive version of that game. So in game development, there are a couple of different approaches you can take, and one is to take the franchises that already exist and continue to develop those and develop deeper content for them and evolve those franchises in new ways. So that's what Miyamoto has to say about the subject. But longtime fans might notice that there's a bit of a contrast between these words and the reality of some of Nintendo's biggest franchises. And don't worry, we'll get there. But before we do, In order to consider Sticker Star's place in the Mario canon, we need to take a look at what the rest of the games in the Mario series had been doing at the time, and see how closely the Paper Mario series fits into that mold. Super Mario RPG Legend of the Seven Stars came into existence when there really wasn't a solid look for Mario yet. Most of the pieces were starting to slot into place, but compared to the more modern entries, this game has a lot of elements that were, well, different, as well as a lot of original races and characters that we never really see in the Mario series again. Probably because Square Enix owns the rights for them, but that's a completely different conversation. It's also one of the few Mario games not to feature Bowser as the villain, instead having him eventually join you as a party member, which is something we'll see more commonly throughout this game's spiritual successors. And while many of the elements that we associate with the Mario series today were built in the early games, for example in Super Mario World, for all intents and purposes, most of the elements that we generally associate with Mario were more or less established by the time the N64 had rolled around. Super Mario 64 was massively influential in how it gave us Mario's voice, how he controls, and the look of Peach's castle, to name a few things. And you can really see this on full display in the first Paper Mario game, which when compared to Super Mario RPG, falls almost exactly in line with the look set by Super Mario 64. The purpose of Paper Mario was to show us what the rest of the Mushroom Kingdom looked like, and to make it a real place, using pretty much all of the species that were introduced in the previous game. When we then move to the next generation, we see interest start to venture outside of the Mushroom Kingdom. Super Mario Sunshine is set in the tropical Isle Delfino, and introduces us to both the Pianta and the Noki, two completely different races not seen before in the Mario universe. The enemies in this game are also fairly unique, sporting quite a different look from our usual Mushroom Kingdom fare. This gives Super Mario Sunshine, in all its divisive glory, a unique charm that makes it stand out amongst the crowd. Also, hot take incoming, I kinda really dig this game. This game is brutal as all hell, and a lot of that is a tad unfair, but I like that this game is so creative and was so willing to experiment that it just makes it really special to me. And as one might expect, the Mario RPGs followed suit. And I do mean RPGs, as in the plural, because there are actually two games to talk about for this part of the timeline. 2003's Mario & Luigi Superstar Saga set its events in the neighboring Bean Bean Kingdom, introducing us to yet more new races and enemy varieties. Unlike Super Mario Sunshine, however, this game doesn't feature Bowser as the main villain. Since it's set in a completely different kingdom, it made sense to make the villain a local threat to that kingdom instead, which brought us the character of Cackletta and her loyal minion Fawful. Yeah, she does ultimately end up possessing Bowser, in case you ever wanted to know what Bowser as a woman would look like, but for the most part, Bowser is not the main bad guy here. In fact, he's barely in the game at all. This was also the time that Nintendo was trying to make Professor Egad a staple character in the Mario series, which didn't last that long. And like both of those games before it, Paper Mario The Thousand Year Door also took us outside of the Mushroom Kingdom to the town of Rogueport and its surrounding areas, giving us another area with a different vibe from that of the mainline games. It also takes the series into a bit of a darker, more gritty direction, whereas both Sunshine and Superstar Saga are fairly lighthearted and sport a bright, happy color palette to match. Although Superstar Saga does have its fair share of unsettling moments in it, see the whole Bowletta thing for that. Despite that, the point here is that this era was built around expanding the Mario universe beyond what was already established in Super Mario 64. The next destination in our timeline is Mario & Luigi Partners in Time, a game whose only real significance is maybe as an unintentional precursor for what was to come. The game is firmly set in the Mushroom Kingdom, albeit in the past, and instead of pitting the plumbers against Bowser and his forces, they're up against the Shroobs, an alien life force that invades the Mushroom Kingdom with the intent of taking it over. The thing to note here is the fact that the main antagonists are an extraterrestrial life form. After that, we finally get to Super Paper Mario, which decided to take us beyond the Mario world and show us what other worlds might look like, which leads us to possibly having the most foreign-looking NPCs and enemies in the entire series. While the denizens of Isle Delfino, the Bean Bean Kingdom, and Rogueport definitely look different from those of the Mushroom Kingdom, they don't seem out of place in a Mario game. Hell, the shrooms still look pretty in line with the Mario world given that they're literally just another race of mushroom people. Super Paper Mario's characters, on the other hand, are a lot more blocky with their segmented bodies and jagged edges. The point here is to elicit a sense in the player that they are not in the same world anymore. But at the same time, the look is so foreign that if you showed someone a picture of a character from this game with no additional information, you wouldn't be able to immediately say that they were in a Mario game. I guess you could say that about some of the characters from the other games I mentioned, but it's especially true here. To complicate matters further, we also see these games draw on the traditional Mario lineup a lot less. We do still frequently run into all the Mario staple enemies, but more often than not, we're interacting with exclusively original characters. Meaning that if we literally removed Mario from the game, you would have no Mario characters on screen for a fairly significant amount of the time. Of course, as one familiar with the Mario series might expect, this focus on more foreign, extraterrestrial enemies has all been leading us to the inevitable conclusion of this trajectory. Yep, just like the spin-off games before it, Super Mario Galaxy brought the main series out of the Mario world to outer space. Which technically isn't the first time this happened, given that Mario went to the moon in the Thousand Year Door, and then explored space literally months prior in Super Paper Mario. Not to mention the numerous times he's driven on Rainbow Road, if you want to count that. All of that aside though, the point here is that during this time, Nintendo was interested in bringing Mario out of the Mushroom Kingdom into more and more foreign environments. Although, when compared to Super Paper Mario, the new characters introduced in Galaxy still fit within the Mario world enough that they still come back sometimes. Hell, the main new character in this game is another princess, one who is so on brand for Mario that she's literally in everything now. Like, she's in Smash for Christ's sake. Up until this point, we've seen that the Mario series, spin-offs included, have had an interest in expanding the Mario universe, including all sorts of new characters and scenarios to place our intrepid plumber into. But that all changed. After Super Mario Galaxy, we start to see a shift in the series away from this more innovative world design and more towards a safer approach, where genuine innovation eventually started to be replaced more and more by gimmicks. Based on what Miyamoto said, it seems to imply that his push for innovation was about finding ways to expand upon pre-existing games instead of just rehashing the same game year after year, like, say, the Call of Duty series does. But what he said is different from what actually happened. Repetition and weird one-off gimmicks became the name of the game for Nintendo. The most blatant example of this comes in the form of New Super Mario Bros. The original DS release was novel given that we hadn't received a proper 2D Mario game for quite some time, but its sequels didn't do too much to advance the formula. New Super Mario Bros. Wii made the most changes with new power-ups and the addition of the ability to have up to 4 players simultaneously, but otherwise it was just New Super Mario Bros. On Wii. And then New Super Mario Bros. 2 came out, and we saw Nintendo lay it on with the gimmicks. This game was just New Super Mario Bros., but with a shitload of coins. Then, they followed that up with New Super Mario Bros., but now you can add a fifth player to place completely unnecessary platforms in the levels. Then they repackaged the game again, but with Luigi. And then repackaged it a third time, except this time, on the Switch. Similarly, Super Mario 3D Land and 3D World are equally as samey a franchise, with both just ultimately having the same rough formula as the other 2D Mario games, but in 3D. This is also the same time that we saw the constant reuse of Bowser Jr., Boom Boom and Pom Pom, and the Koopalings in every Mario game as bosses. Instead of making new and interesting adversaries for Mario to face, anytime Nintendo needs a boss battle, they just throw one of these guys at you, and you'll always defeat them the exact same way. Jump on their head, avoid them as they bounce around in their shell, rinse and repeat 2 more times, and you're done. This was also the time that we saw a mainline 3D Mario game get a direct sequel in the form of Super Mario Galaxy 2, which is extremely solid in its own right, but ultimately just feels like an expansion pass for Super Mario Galaxy, as the game does very little to differentiate itself from its predecessor, besides the fact that it has Yoshi in it, which is always a plus in my book. The nature of the project wasn't lost on the developers either. The director, Koichi Hayashida, said in an Iwata Asks interview, "I felt like I had done everything with the first one. We'd come up with tons of ideas and then packed in all of the good ones. And I didn't think there were many left over." In that same interview, the game's producer, Yoshiaki Koizumi, said that at one point Miyamoto had told him, "Why not just make Super Mario Galaxy 1.5? So ultimately, this game was made with the sole intention of just being more Super Mario Galaxy, instead of something to push the series forward, which again isn't necessarily a bad thing, but fits into a wider pattern. If you want to know the full story about this, I highly suggest you check out Video Game Storytime's video on the development of Super Mario Galaxy 2, and how some of this might be the reason that the game was not included in Super Mario 3D All-Stars. And while the Mario and Luigi series was able to avoid some of the bigger traps that the main series was heading towards, there were still some signs of the games also becoming a little bit samey. 2009's Bowser's Inside Story added a lot of unique things to the series, such as the ability to switch back and forth between two completely different parties, with a change in perspective from 2D side-scrolling to top-down exploration, as well as the most unique aspect, the giant Bowser fights, where you had to literally turn your DS on its side and battle in a completely different combat system than what was in the rest of the game. We then saw a lot of this get duplicated in the follow-up, Mario & Luigi Dream Team. Top-down perspective in the real world, 2D went inside Luigi's dreams, and while you don't play as Bowser anymore, you still have different combat systems between the real and dream worlds. We even see the giant Bowser fights come back, but this time as giant Luigi fights. I will admit though that talking about the game like this does make it sound worse than it actually is. Mario & Luigi Dream Team does do some fairly unique things, especially with how you dodge attacks while fighting within the dream world. But we also do get our fair share of gimmicks, this time in the form of special moves requiring the usage of the built-in gyroscope, which I'm going to assume works fine. But I made the mistake of playing this game while on a road trip, and I can say that gyro controls don't mix well with being inside of a moving vehicle. Although again, compared to the rest of the games that were being released around this time, Dream Team is one of the more unique Mario games to come from this era. And that brings us to Paper Mario, which is where we start to see more than just generification in gimmicks, but the outright removal of elements that were in the original in favor of a new system that relies on a gimmick. And this was also the time that the characters started to become super aware that they were made of paper, because prior to this point, besides a few powers in the Thousand Year Door, that was never something that was acknowledged in this world. A lot of fans seem to blame this on Miyamoto, but this one actually may be on the team itself. Going back to the Iwata interview with the Sticker Star team, it seems like the idea to abandon RPG elements came directly from Tanabe and the creative team. According to Tanabe, "At first we were making a lot of individual allies as a regular RPG, but then we decided to focus on stickers in order to make a clear change with the previous games in the series. It was like we started all over again by throwing out the system, including those characters that we had made up to that point." To which Iwata responded with, "You purposefully threw out the basic RPG structure." Tanabe then said, "Yes. We decided to make it so that players would face stronger opponents by throwing out the concept of experience points and levels in favor of gradually gathering stronger stickers. I had actually been thinking for a long time that I wanted to get rid of the RPG experience points. In the freshly picked Tingle's Rosy Rupee Land game, which Kudo-san and I worked on together, the player character didn't develop at all. We adopted a system whereby they solved everything with money. This time we decided to do everything with stickers. We decided on a system whereby in battle, instead of attack commands, you fight using the stickers that you have gathered in the field or bought in town." Now, I have talked about this idea before, and how this concept of only having money isn't terrible on paper. In fact, games like Devil May Cry and Bayonetta get along just fine using a store-based progression system. The Origami King manages to fix quite a bit of the issue with Sticker Star by adding the accessory system. However, the underlying point here is that the team completely changed the system and removed RPG elements because they didn't like it, and so they could focus completely on their gimmick of choice. What's more frustrating, though, is that Tanabe has demonstrated that he understands how to properly build on a formula without just resorting to gimmicks. For Christ's sake, this guy managed to put out an extremely competent Luigi's Mansion game just over a year ago. Moving back to Paper Mario, though, we find something interesting about Tanabe's decision to scrap elements from previous games in service of a single gameplay element. He saw this very thing happen when he worked on Super Paper Mario, where the game's director, Ryota Kawade, made the same call to remove RPG combat entirely from the game, which he laid out in an interview with Nintendo of Europe. After we developed the previous game, Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door, I wanted to make a game that can surprise people with brand new features within the Paper Mario concept. Then, when I was drawing up some plans, I came up with an idea of switching between 2D and 3D. I felt that the more traditional Mario-style battles worked better in this game in order to effectively utilize this idea of dimension swapping, which is why we opted for this style. This decision was backed up by Tanabe in the same interview, where he made a few noteworthy remarks. I promptly decided to make this game when I received Mr. Kawade's presentation about the system of switching between 2D and 3D worlds. And I also saw eye to eye with Mr. Kawade about the idea that this system would probably fit better with action-adventure style gameplay. Then we chose the direction of refraining from the traditional RPG style battles, even though action skills won't be required as much as in an original Mario game. I did ask the staff to keep the RPG-like storyline, though. In case my tone of voice wasn't obvious, take note of that last sentence. That will be very important in a bit. Just tuck it away in the back of your brain for now. So we've demonstrated that Tanabe has already seen that Paper Mario isn't necessarily one thing, and that the series can evolve and change as he sees fit. But there's still more to it than that. The biggest thing to note about Super Paper Mario is the fact that they deliberately only changed the gameplay, but kept everything else more or less the same. We've still got 8 chapters, with each one giving you one of the magical MacGuffins that you need to save the world, which then guides you to the location of the next one. Each chapter also has some spin on the gameplay in order to make it unique from the others, and the series' trademark humor hasn't gone anywhere. It's literally just the style of gameplay that's different. Yes, partners have been replaced by these little guys known as pixels, and it's true that they have very little characterization outside of your initial meeting with them. Except for one of them. We'll get back to her. However, we see that these characters still serve some of the same purposes gameplay-wise, and it's not like having the idea of a party of characters is completely gone either. In exchange for replacing partners with what are essentially the various items from The Legend of Zelda, but with a face, you get to play as other characters who aren't Mario, being able to play as Luigi, Princess Peach, and even Bowser. Although you will still be using Mario the most out of the crew, because a lot of the gameplay is built around playing with perspective, requiring you to switch to 3D in order to solve puzzles, which is an ability that only Mario has. The big thing to note about this game is the continual opening up of the game's world by means of giving you new abilities, and that's something that may have changed up at Nintendo. Recently, Nintendo has seen a major shift in their biggest franchises, most of them anyways, and has adopted what seems to be a new approach to game design. This idea originally comes from another creator known as Steve Gaming, who recently made a video talking about this concept and why Paper Mario's old formula had to die as a result. He called the old way of doing things Metroid-like ability growth, which is the idea where you gate progression behind the acquisition of new items or abilities. Steve invokes Metroid for the name because of how the first game in that series features this concept right out of the gate, where you need to obtain the Morph Ball in order to progress beyond the first room. The concept is present in pretty much every Nintendo game from the early days, being most prominent in games like The Legend of Zelda and, well, Metroid. What makes this concept so brilliant is that it removes the need for overbearing tutorials, as you generally lock the player in the room where they get a new ability and require them to use said ability in order to get out. It's also a fairly easy way to enforce a linear game structure without just having the player run down a hallway for 50 hours. This way, you give the player the illusion of an open world without actually having one. Paper Mario typically uses this idea to gradually open up parts of the hub town so that there's always something new to find when you finish each chapter. What Steve claims about this concept is that Nintendo is, in essence, abandoning this structure in favor of a more truly open-world approach. He talks about how both Breath of the Wild and Super Mario Odyssey effectively stop giving you rewards for collecting Korok seeds and moons after a certain point, giving the impression that you're not technically supposed to collect all of them, but rather, pick and choose which ones you want to get, and in what order you want to get them, if at all in the case of the Korok seeds. Because of this more open approach, as a result, we see the games give you pretty much every ability you need in order to complete the game right then and there at the start. Now granted, Steve does admit that he doesn't have any proof that this shift is being imposed onto other games, and mentions that it's more of a conspiracy theory, to use his words. However, if that is the case, there are some flaws with this idea. The main one being that it kind of only works for open world games, which Paper Mario isn't. And we also don't know that the concept of Metroid-like ability growth is completely gone. Frankly, the ultimate test of this idea won't come for at least a few more years when Metroid Prime 4 comes out. Although, if I can level with you guys right now, I'm not convinced that game even exists. The same goes for Bayonetta 3. It's been years, and we still haven't seen a single screenshot. Picks or it didn't happen, Nintendo. Where was I again? Oh yeah, the validity of Steve's theory. TLDR, there's no evidence within Nintendo that there is a massive shift in game design philosophy that's rippling throughout every series, but it's an interesting observation nonetheless, given that it comes from two of Nintendo's biggest franchises. Also, Pokemon Sword and Shield kind of does that too, but then again, that game is just a hallway sim for like 90% of the adventure, so moving on. The last thing we need to tackle is the reason that Sticker Star removed the story, and why, even after it was brought back, the developers are no longer allowed to use new original characters or seemingly bring back old ones. Narrative design is definitely the most interesting conversation when it comes to games, and to really discuss it, we need to go over the basic anatomy of what a story is. What, that sounds redundant, you say? Everyone knows what a story is already? Okay, but please hear me out. There is a point to this, I promise. Once upon a time, there was a hero who had a desire. He then encountered an event that threw his life into disarray and interfered with obtaining that desire. This event caused a problem for the hero. However, our hero persevered and tried to overcome the problem, and failed. Then, there was a reversal of fortune, which caused even more trouble for our hero, which was followed up by an even greater problem that put him at an even bigger risk than before. Finally, there was one last problem that threatened the hero with the most risk out of all of the problems so far. And thankfully, our hero managed to resolve the final problem in order to gain the object of his desire, and they lived happily ever after. Well, until the sequel, that is. That example was borrowed from game designer Scott Rogers in his book Level Up, and I chose to use it because it fits really nicely with another point that he makes in the same chapter, that all games have a story in some capacity. Game designer Jesse Schell, in his book The Art of Game Design, identifies two types of story structure found in games. The first is what he calls the string of pearls, which is exhibited by having a game consist of a series of gameplay segments where the player is given relative freedom and a goal that they must complete in order to move on. This works to allow games to maintain the fairly linear structure needed for most forms of traditional storytelling. On the flip side, we have what's called the story machine, which is inherent in pretty much all games because, as Schell puts it, a good game is like a story machine, generating sequences of events that are very interesting indeed. Not all games have an overt story, nor do they need to. Tetris doesn't need a reason to exist. It's fucking Tetris. However, all games do generate a narrative of sorts by your interaction with the game. When you play games, at least the ones that aren't walking simulators, the gameplay creates the basic structure that Rogers outlines. You're the hero, and you are either given a goal, or you make your own goals in some cases, be it to complete a level or craft a really powerful item. You are then faced with a series of challenges until you ultimately end up achieving that goal, or get fed up and quit. Who's to say? This is especially apparent in open-world sandbox-style games such as Minecraft, and with online multiplayer experiences like Fortnite. The games have very little in terms of a pre-written narrative, but what happens during gameplay creates a unique narrative experience in itself, which is part of why Let's Plays and Twitch streams of these games are so popular. And it's that is the key to understanding Mario, and why our boy Miyamoto doesn't seem to like more extensive stories. In a recent interview for The New Yorker, he had this to say on the subject. Video games are an active medium. In a sense, they don't require complex emotions from the designer. It's the players who take what we give them and respond to them in their own ways. Complex emotions are difficult to deal with interactive media. I've been involved in movies, and passive media is much better suited to take on those themes. With Nintendo, the appeal of our characters is that they bring families together. Our games are designed to provide a warm feeling. Everyone is able to enjoy their time playing or watching. To him, games are not the place to tell deep, complex, and emotional stories. That takes away from the story you generate as the player. Now, I'm going to push back on this a bit, mainly on the whole passive versus interactive media dichotomy that he set up here. Schell talks about what he calls the myth of passive entertainment. This idea is that no form of media is truly a passive experience. A story, or at least a good one, should be engaging the audience on some level. The idea that the mechanics of traditional storytelling, which are innate to the human ability to communicate, are somehow nullified by interactivity is absurd. It is a poorly told story that doesn't compel the listener to think and make decisions during the telling. When one is engaged in any kind of storyline, interactive or not, one is continually making decisions. What will happen next? What will the hero do? Where did the rabbit go? Don't open that door! The difference only comes in the participant's ability to take action. The desire to act and all the thoughts and emotions that go with that are present in both. A masterful storyteller knows how to create this desire within a listener's mind, and then knows exactly how and when not, to fulfill it. This skill translates well into interactive media, although it is made more difficult because the storyteller must predict, account for, respond to, and smoothly integrate the actions of the participant into the experience. In other words, while interactive storytelling is more challenging than traditional storytelling, by no means is it fundamentally different. And since story is an important part of so many game designs, game designers are well served to learn all they can about traditional storytelling techniques. Rogers also pushes back on another aspect of Miyamoto's statement, that somehow the fact that Mario is meant to be family-friendly precludes him from being able to tackle complex themes. I have often heard developers protest over using complex ideas and themes because it's for kids. But think about children's literature. Children's classics like Where the Wild Things Are, Heidi, and The Chronicles of Narnia are full of complex themes, interactions, and emotions. If it's good enough for kids' books, it should be good enough for kids' games. What's interesting is that even though Miyamoto says things like this, Paper Mario the Origami King had a pretty traditional story. Yeah, it was only 6 chapters instead of 8, but it was still a pretty involved story that actually had characters and interactions, and even some fairly complex themes. This game literally has one of Mario's companions, Bobby, sacrifice himself to save Olivia. Spoilers, by the way. This part of the game explores the idea of finding purpose and meaning in one's relatively short existence. It's really powerful stuff. This is what Mario is capable of. This is what made the early Paper Mario games so great. The way they handle themes like sacrifice and grief, but package them in a way that kids can understand. However, it's very clear from the fact that the story was heavily stripped out from Paper Mario Sticker Star, and the fact that Nintendo continues to impose restrictions on character designs, that something happened in the series that caused Nintendo to become somewhat adverse to the idea for a while. Which brings us back, yet again, to Super Paper Mario. So then, what was it about this game that caused future entries to change so much that they're no longer allowed to use original characters anymore? Why did the immediate successor to this game not really have a story? Well, supposedly that's due to a poll conducted on Club Nintendo that supposedly found that less than 1% of players found the story interesting. Which is strange given how prominent it was in the game and how much the community talks about it on boards like Reddit. Of course, this may just be the result of unrepresentative internet samples again, and what I'm seeing online is just the result of carefully curated posts meant to reinforce what I already believe about the world. But there may also be some flaws with this poll. The numbers just seem too off to me. There's a lot of variables that make this kind of polling potentially flawed, such as how many users actually took the time to log onto Club Nintendo and fill this thing out? Did they read the directions properly when it told them to check all that applied? How representative of the overall consumer base were the people that took these? Were they older, or was it mostly kids who skipped through all the dialogue? All of these variables make it so that the potential issues with Club Nintendo may in fact make it even more unrepresentative of what people actually think than that mistake of a website that houses all of the unfiltered opinions of the world's worst idiots that for some reason I cannot ever get enough of. Nintendo can say all the things they want about fans not liking the story, but in reality, it may be because they didn't like the story. And that might be for understandable reasons on their part. Some of the things this game did went way out of what Mario has ever done in the past, making it by far one of the darkest and most tragic games in the entire Mario canon. The game opens with this intro telling us about a magical book that contains a record of the future, which unfortunately also contained a prophecy foretelling the end of the world, leading to it being labeled the Dark Prognosticus and being sealed away. Flash forward to the present day, and we see that the villain of our story, Count Bleck, has stolen the Dark Book and has used it to unleash what's known as the Chaos Heart in order to set the prophecy in motion through an arranged wedding between Peach and Bowser. So that's where he got the idea from. This scene frankly encapsulates a strange dichotomy that this game has set up. It mixes a very bright and colorful aesthetic with this rather dark story tone, and this sequence with its completely ridiculous concept works so well to set this up. Once we're in the game, we get our basic objective. Mario is the hero outlined in a book called The Light Prognosticus, which was written in order to counteract the Dark One, meaning that our plumber has to travel the world, or worlds in this case, and collect the 8 pure hearts in order to stop Count Bleck's evil plan to destroy the world. It's at this point we're introduced to Tippy, Mario's main companion throughout the adventure. As mentioned, this game goes places. There's one chapter where Tippy gets kidnapped by a chameleon who is a complete caricature of both geek culture and the otaku lifestyle. We see his lair is decked out with kitty robot maids. No, that's not a joke. Literally all the enemies in this section are cats. Oh, and Peach gets forced into a dating sim with our chameleon kidnapper because our caricature wouldn't be complete if he wasn't also a giant creep. This section, however, is fairly lighthearted and fun and has all sorts of fun lines such as, "I love going on message boards and complaining about games I've never played," which is not a real thing. No human being on Earth has ever done this. In In another chapter, you end up helping a species of prehistoric people free some of the other villagers who've been kidnapped by another species of sentient flowers, only to find out at the end that these people you sided with were kinda in the wrong. And we learn that they were throwing their trash in the river that was poisoning the plant people's water supply. And we only find this out after we killed, I'm sorry, wilted their king. Whoops.
Are we the baddies?
I bet you didn't expect Mario to become a moral tale about how it's bad to litter and maybe you should try talking to people before you go killing their leaders. But don't you worry, it gets even weirder from here. The chapter immediately after that sees us enter a world that's on the brink of destruction, only for Mario to fail to reach the pure heart before it's too late. Meaning that we have to go back in after the destruction, where we're treated to this completely blank void that only contains small scraps of architecture, but no NPCs. Meaning that we were literally introduced to a people, only to watch them die. And if somehow that still wasn't dark enough for you, then buckle up, my friend, because after this chapter, we watch all of our heroes get killed, or at least implied to be killed, by one of Count Black's minions, Dementio, and then they get sent to this world's equivalent of hell. Do you see why maybe Nintendo doesn't want their development teams to have too much creative freedom with the franchise? Does this seem a little much for you? Although, as we've already mentioned, kids can probably handle this stuff. But some of these are complex themes, and Miyamoto doesn't like those. Above all of that, though, we've still got one more thing to talk about. And that thing to talk about revolves around Mario's first pixel companion, Tippy. The one I told you to remember for later? Yeah, she's finally coming back into the picture here. At first glance, Tippy doesn't seem to be that important. She's the game's mandatory helper character who can give you info on enemies and help you solve puzzles, but the game slowly hints that there's something else that we don't quite know about yet. At the end of each chapter, we're treated to this fairly innocuous black screen with white text. The key aspect here, though, is what this text contains, which is a dialogue between two characters. As we progress through the game, we learn that these characters' names are Blumiere and Timpani, and the story of how they meet and fall in love. The only problem is that Blumiere is a member of the Tribe of Darkness, and thus is forbidden from marrying humans, which includes our girl Timpani. At first, these exchanges seem fairly disconnected from the main story, but as the game progresses, it starts to become clear who these characters are. At the end of Chapter 3, we see Count Black's assistant, Nastasia, plead with him to call the plan off, only for him to refuse to listen to her. After Chapter 4, she mentions that Black probably wouldn't be on the path he's on if she had been that girl. It's also after this chapter that we learn that Tippy was originally a human who had been transformed by Merlin into a pixel to keep her from dying. Are you starting to see where this might be headed? Good, because Chapter 6 is where it becomes extremely blatant, where we have our first face-to-face meeting between Mario and the Count since the beginning of the game, where towards the end of the conversation, Black drops Timpani's name, which leads to a fairly flustered reaction from Tippy, followed by Black's hasty retreat. It's after this chapter's end that we start to see our characters put the pieces together as well. Black starts to suspect that Tippy might actually be Timpani, and Tippy starts to remember more and more things about her past. It's also at this point where we get to the part of the story where it's revealed that Timpani was killed by Blumiere's father as punishment for his son's disobedience. The last two chapters of this story bring everything full circle. We see the moment that Blumiere takes hold of the Dark Prognosticus and swears off his old name, killing the rest of his tribe in the process, vowing to end all worlds as he sees no more meaning in life now that his lover is gone. Jesus, dude, that's like a bit much, don't you think? That'd be like if when Romeo saw Juliet in her tomb, instead of poisoning himself, he decided to go on a murderous rampage and kill everyone in Verona. Would've made for a better ending, honestly. And it's during the final confrontation that everything the story has been building towards comes into picture. Tippy pointedly calls Count Black Blumiere and asks him to stop his plan, with Bleck saying, "It's too late to stop things now." And so our heroes and lovers do battle. Thankfully though, unlike Romeo and Juliet, the story has a somewhat happier ending. After his defeat, Count Bleck asks the player to finish him off and get rid of the Chaos Heart, ending his plan. However, before our heroes are able to do so, Dementio attacks him, only to be shielded by Anastasia, before ultimately admitting that it doesn't matter if Bleck dies, and then just takes the Chaos Heart for himself and combines it with a brainwashed Luigi in order to form the final boss of the game. And no, this doesn't come out of nowhere, it is set up throughout the experience. Just trust me on that. The importance of this moment from a story perspective is that it's here where Count Bleck ultimately redeems himself and is convinced both by Tippi and the rest of his minions not to give up, which ultimately creates enough love and hope to reform the Pure Hearts in order to stop Dementio. Once the dust is settled, our two lovers make the final move to stop the Chaos Heart. At the altar we saw at the start of our story, we see Blumiere and Timpani renew their vows of love to seal the Chaos Heart for good. Fade to black, we see one last exchange between them, this time presumably in the present day, and everyone wakes up alive and well on Flipside with the worlds restored and Blumiere and Timpani missing. Not dead. The game never says they're dead. In fact, after the credits, it's implied that they lived on happily after that point. So there's a lot to unpack here, and a lot for I Only Like Family-Friendly Games Miyamoto to take issue with. First and most obvious is the whole watching a world get destroyed and then going back into the ruins. The health thing isn't as big a deal in my opinion, because the whole area is much more influenced by Greek mythology than it is by the fire and brimstone associated with the Christian interpretation of hell. Arguably the biggest thing, however, is the main plot focusing so much on two completely original characters, one of whom spends the majority of the game being a genocidal maniac. I don't know about you, but that sounds a bit more Final Fantasy to me than it does Mario. It's very possible that Nintendo saw this and was like, nope, no more original characters in our Mario games. The original characters weren't the reason Super Paper Mario was the way it was, but there is no way that Nintendo would have allowed this to be done with any of their existing characters. So by pulling the plug on original characters, it allows Nintendo to exert more control over the Mario brand. But the result is that every Mario game starts to feel very similar to each other. Hopefully, after all of that, you have a bit of a better understanding of some of the possible reasons as to why Nintendo is being so restrictive on Paper Mario as of late. From a change in design philosophy that demands a more generic look to the series, or the fact that the people who worked on it don't like mechanics that are fundamental to how RPGs work, although granted, if Tanabe really has an issue with experience points, he could literally just come up with some type of stat enhancement grids like pretty much every other RPG has now. However, it may also be the fact that Nintendo just thought that they afforded too much creative freedom to their developers and don't like where it went, because as we know, all corporations must have complete control over their brands at all times. But who's to fucking say? What we do know, however, is that there may well just be light at the end of the tunnel. And by that I mean a very slight glimmer that may just be a reflection and not actually an exit. But maybe there's something in the series that bodes well for us. The good news is that Mario has broken from the monotony a bit with Super Mario Odyssey, which features characters that are just as wacky and alien looking as some of the ones in Super Paper Mario. Some of which create a really uncanny valley effect when placing our colorful Italian plumber in the world with them, but that's a completely different conversation to have. The bad news is literally everything else. Super Mario Odyssey is it in terms of cool, unique Mario characters. Everything else they've released looks like it came out pre-Odyssey. Although that may be due to the fact that they've mostly just been porting games since then. On top of that, it seems like Mario RPGs may be very much dead,
as the Mario and Luigi series died a slow and quite painful death at the hands of bad business decisions from their developer Alpha Dream. Who would have thought that continuing to develop for the 3DS 2 years into the Switch's lifecycle would have been a bad idea? Certainly I wouldn't have. Although, maybe there's hope for the series yet. Nintendo did file a trademark for Mario and Luigi about a year ago, so there may be something. Probably not, but I can hope, can't I? Ultimately, I liked Paper Mario the Origami King, but I'm not hopeful that we're gonna see a more traditional-looking Paper Mario game, at least anytime soon. Oh well, at least Bug Fables is pretty decent. I do have my problems with it, but if you're looking for a classic Paper Mario experience, this game is just enough to give you your fix. Thank you so much for watching this video. I know I ended on a bit of a downer, but I just don't know what else there is to say other than the Origami King is cool and play Bug Fables. Also, if you haven't played any of the Mario and Luigi games, you really should. All right, peace out everyone, have a nice night. This video is rather long and I'm a bit tired after all of this, so goodbye.